we have so many folks on the panel, and I want to get the discussion going, but there are all the names. Should we introduce everyone, or we can see all the names? We should probably just jump right in. We have many topics to cover, and you know, this is a very impressive panel, and there's so many things going on in media and the television business, and if anybody has all the answers, it's going to be these folks. We know that for sure, right? Everybody has all the answers to all the confusing things happening. Really, one thing I wanted to say is I've been paying attention to this for a long time, and I'm sure it's on everybody's radar, but we're at a crossroads, really, in the business. I would say everybody would agree with that, right? In terms of where everybody is, and it seems like the image I have in my head is that it is the crossroads, and everybody's there at the same time. And there's a huge cluster of people gathered in this one place and trying to figure out how to move forward. But also that means you don't want to go in the wrong direction at this point. So I'm just looking for someone to jump in and tell me, is this an exciting time, a scary time, or something in between?
I think we look very excited up here.
So. I feel a little bit like Captain Kirk.
Well, you know, you said to me the other day, this is not a time for the faint of heart.
In all seriousness, it's a great question. I'll jump in, why not? I think this is clearly a time of change, not for the faint of heart. But if you are creative, you know, think differently, are comfortable with uncertainty, I think these are really exciting times, too. And the other thing I'll say is, you know, sometimes when industries change and dynamics change, it's very clarifying, too. So I know that at our company, you know, we've talked a lot about, you know, these taking the changing times as an opportunity to really refocus on what it is that, for example, we do best. What are our core values and our core competencies? Understanding what we do and where we fit into this global ecosystem and where we don't. And sometimes change and challenge has a way of clarifying things that I think eventually pay dividends.
Well, that's Ben Franklin who said the noose makes you concentrate very well. But
yes, that's why he's Ben Franklin and I'm not.
So I want to ask Barb, because Barb said something the other day about how linear TV is not going away. And I think, Marianne, you said something about linear TV is still a superior experience. There are people who would say, well, it's you know, still a strong business, but it's in a fade mode. How do you counter that?
You know, I think we do believe that that linear television is not dead. I mean, I think from our point of view, we're not on a series of cliffs. We're in some rolling hills. So some stuff is climbing up in importance, and some stuff is maybe sliding down in importance. And when you look across that valley and you see the layers of the hills, you're sort of trying to figure out what's in the foreground and what's in the background. But I don't think it's cliffs. I don't think linear TV just suddenly one day is going to crash, nor do I think that suddenly one day one thing is at the peak of the mountain. Those were great references for where we are, aren't they? Like, that was good. That was good. So I think the challenge and the opportunity, and yeah, I'm mostly excited most of the time. Some days I'm not, but is just to really try to get that focus on which hill I'm on and which needs to be in the foreground today and which is falling to the background, and that requires a different kind of thinking than I think we all had in a business that for a long time was really, really straightforward.
Marianne, tell us why it's a superior experience still.
So I want to just build on what Barb said, because I'm new to the crowd, right? And this industry is strong. It's so much stronger than the industry I came from. I came from a world where we were losing hundreds of thousands of home phone customers every year, and we had to climb ourselves out of a $300 million hole at the beginning of every year just to kind of keep going, right? So I come over to media, and it's, how many of the best shows do we have? Tell me again how many people watch linear TV, and our revenue is flat. Like, this is okay. So from where I sit, it's about course correcting. You know, you guys come from a place of growth. I've come from a place of decline, and now I'm flat. I feel great, right? It's all relative. But it's it's a beautiful business, and you know, we've done a lot of work with on studies around the effectiveness of TV, and that's a beautiful thing. The numbers speak for themselves. So yeah, I'm excited. It's a bit terrifying because I don't know the industry that I'm walking into, but
neither do we anymore. So.
I feel like, John, like you're sort of in, as change roils all over the business, someone in your position is kind of in the catbird seat in a way. You can go to many different places, right? And that's to your advantage, is it not?
Yeah, I'm a frequent flyer on Air Canada. So, well, you know, E1 is an independent studio, so we're not in the platform business. We talk about being in that business a lot, but part of me loves not being in it because we're a content company. So we don't necessarily have to think about linear television the same way that some of my colleagues up here think about it. For us, we've definitely clarified our view on what we are as a content company. I think in this really crowded, noisy, you know, viewer choice environment, we've moved away from sort of, you know, we want to do a lot of stuff in the middle to sort of really looking at high-end, noisy content, because when there's so much choice now, your content strategy changes significantly because we're selling to all these platforms, linear and non-linear. So I don't know where the business is going.
Do creative people have any preference anymore?
I think that they just want to make great shows. I think what's happening now is it's less about the platform and more about the show, and I think that's happening in our channel business. You know, viewers aren't watching channels, they're watching shows, and so I think that clarity certainly is something that we all understand now more than ever. So I think, you know, the future is going to be about really strong brands, because curation is becoming very important. Mm-hmm. There's just way too much content out there. We all know that, you know, people only watch 16 or 17 channels among...
That's a lot.
It's a lot of channels.
I mean, the figure is usually 10 or 12. You think are they up to 17 now?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Well, I do, but I have a lot of free time. So for us, it's really about the content. You know, I don't know the future.
Sure everyone here could tell me exactly what it's going to be like in 2 years, right? The future is so clear.
Yeah. But content, I feel, you know, if we have a really strong, clear content strategy, and for us, it's more about moving away from the
middle. But who knows?
High-end or kind of very niche targeted content.
But does anybody know where the viewers are going? Where do you think the viewers are going? I mean, the viewers have, you talk about choice, they have choice of so many things, and their money is, you know, a big factor. Are they going to continue to spend money? They're looking for ways to not spend money. I mean, there's an awful lot of challenge in that area, isn't there?
Depends on the age.
And of course, it depends on how old the viewers are, of course. Yeah. I mean, Doug, you have a lot of children's programming, right?
Yep.
How many of those children watch television?
Still a lot, but a lot of them are watching it on nonlinear platforms, too. Mm-hmm. And that's a reality that is an opportunity at the same time as a challenge for us. And the challenge at the moment is measurement. We know the kids watch a ton of content on a nonlinear basis, but it's just not measured today. So that came up in Nancy's comments yesterday, too. It's a real issue for the industry. It is a great time to make content up there. It's a real opportunity. And there's more and more great content being made, but there's more and more inventory, and there's less and less measurement. Right. And the economics of our business are hinging on advertising at one level.
Right. I have a 7-year-old son, and the other day, it was like 2 weeks ago, he came back from the grandparents, and the grandparents have television. They don't have a Netflix or whatever. Mm-hmm. So he comes back to me knowing what I do. He looks at me very serious with his 7-year-old face. He said, "Papa, you know, watching television, it's okay." but you know, YouTube and Netflix, that's really cool. You know, and I was like, I was shocked for a brief second, you mm-hmm. know, like, but that's it, you know.
Well, I mean, I've seen kids, very young kids, I mean, before they can talk, they have an iPad.
Yeah.
Really, before they can talk.
I have a 2-year-old, even worse. She can't really talk yet, you know, but she knows the code to the iPad.
Yeah.
Of the 7-year-old iPad, you know, 7 years old. And then she does like, and she looks. Right. And it's this red button. Mm-hmm. You know? It's like,
So you have that generation that you have to think about where they're going. But even people, I was flying out here and I sat next to a young woman, I'd say she was in her early 30s, maybe 30 years old. She lived somewhere near Calgary. And I started to talk to her and I said, you know, how much television do you watch? And she said, I don't own a television. I said, you don't own a television? No, don't own a television. So you watch only streaming online. She said, well, I don't even have really what, I only watch on my phone. The only thing I do is use my phone. Yeah. And I thought, well, this is a modern consumer who is really going to be hard to reach in these traditional ways.
It's not so much about the platform anymore. I mean, it's like you're going to have traditional television available on all platforms, or whether they watch it on their iPhone or iPad or whatever. I think it's about there is different content for different platforms. I think we're at a crossroad where, like, free TV is going to have linear television, going to have very different stuff than you're going to have on digital platforms. Mm-hmm.
One of the things to follow up on that we're noticing is that, and I completely agree, and I think one of the big challenges that a lot of us have that are in both the content and the platform business, a company like ours is in both, is that our base business is really built on the traditional, you know, selling demographics to the advertisers. I have to say, it's a great business. I mean, the thing is, we're talking about, you know, relative growth, and we're talking about a lot of things, but it is a fundamentally very good business. And so on the one hand, you want to do everything you can to make sure that business thrives. At the same time, we know that younger audiences are aging into those demos. Well, they're learning how to consume content in a completely different way than, for example, I did. And we see it all the time. So you're sort of having to sort of manage both ends of this. One of the things that we're noticing is the move toward more premium, longer form content on digital and mobile platforms. So I think even there, we're starting to see an evolution of what we thought was, you know, the YouTubers doing short form videos, where we're starting to see some really interesting things. I'm hearing that companies like Snapchat are of all companies, is exploring a strategy around long form, premium content, feature length content on Snapchat. Yeah. So they believe, and I think that there's reason to pay attention to what they're doing, that their 100 million or so subscribers are perfectly fine watching premium long-form content on the mobile
phone.
Device.
Yeah.
And I think we take cues from that.
Well, premium content, all content, is expensive. And in order to fund that, you need a revenue stream that's reliable. And if you are depending on advertising for that, there clearly is a confusion in that business as well, as to where they can spend, how they can spend, and I'm not sure they've kept up very well. And certainly the measurement is another factor. That's a challenge for everybody, yeah. I think. But what are conversations like with advertisers now? Are they saying, we don't know how much we can put into this pool, we got to move our money around? Hasn't that become a huge challenge for everybody?
Do you
want to
go?
No, go ahead. Well, so the conversations that I've been having are around mix and the appropriate mix from kind of broadcast television through to specialty all the way through to the digital properties. And let's be careful of overuse of the word digital as one big thing, right? There's digital premium video content on certain platforms. There's digital search. And the conversations that we've been having, the studies that we've done are around when you have a mix of broadcast television or at a home or any of these things, it stimulates search. And the moment of truth is when they get to that website and go there, right? And we've proven that we get lift of over 70% on search with a good television campaign. So, excuse me, the conversations that we're having are around that, around its reach, its engagement. It's still a massive audience. Like, again, remember where I come from. I say, oh, that many people? That's pretty good. I didn't know 10 years ago it was more or less or whatever. Like, it's been pretty consistent. So it's calming everyone down. And actually, with the agencies, the conversations aren't bad. It's the marketers that we have to get at who are sort of feeling under pressure. You know, you're not going to get fired buying Google. You know, but it's because that's the new thing, and it works, it's effective, but it's a strategic selling platform mix conversation that we're starting to have.
But one of the things that digital has done, I think, more than anything else, is enhanced people's ability to avoid commercials. And this younger audience, they don't have any tolerance for commercials at all. They don't know what that is. So I wonder why the advertising community isn't coming up with more innovative ways to put something on the air that is a commercial but doesn't feel like it, look like it, and you use the screen in some creative way. Is anything like that happening?
Yeah, it's yes. Starting. It's, I mean, as again on the studio side, I mean, you know, networks are advertisers are connecting more and more to the content. You know, they're trying to skip the middleman. because you can skip ads. So I think we are living in an age where, you know, branded content, the integration of advertising and with entertainment is becoming more and more prevalent. It's a lot easier in non-scripted competition reality shows. It's harder in drama, because the integrity of the show, I think, will be diminished if you as a viewer feeling you're watching a big commercial.
Right.
But it's starting to happen.
Can't be wearing a shirt with a big logo on it.
Yes, But it's starting to happen, and I think you're going to see more and more of that. And I also think you're seeing the nature of ads change.
Why aren't there 10-second ads, for example?
Well, I think the point underneath all this is that the whole world of, that we all play in here is becoming more and more personalized and more customized as every day goes on. So when you ask where are the viewers going, they're going everywhere. That's the point. It isn't about figuring out which place they're going to go. It's acknowledging they're going everywhere. And to an advertiser, what that means is, how do I chase them? How do I track them? How do I go over there for this one, and how do I go over there for that one? And so really what I think the underscoring challenge we're facing today is what Doug touched on. It's about measurement, and it's about data, so that then we can help that advertiser find each person where they are, when they are, and track them, stay with them, be on that journey with them as they customize and personalize their own viewing experience. So I think it's about really acknowledging that we're going to play in a very multidimensional world. And we gotta let go of this idea of trying to get it all back funneled into a nice tidy place where we can control it again, and appreciate that it is just gonna be everywhere, and that everywhere is gonna look different, every day. And our challenge is to go on that journey with the viewer, with the advertiser, because we certainly believe that the advertising is not going away. Advertisers desperately need to get to this audience, and we desperately need advertisers' money to fund the whole thing. So there is a real powerful connection between advertisers and content creators, and we don't call ourselves broadcasters anymore, but deliverers of content. And that's a relationship that we're working really, really hard at.
And use the word desperately, and I think there's certainly that sort of... kind of pressure on both sides of the business. But Jens, you wanted to say something.
I think also that in general, the power of linear television is still very much up there. I mean, when you look at like what kind of ads are running on television, I mean, especially in Europe. In Europe, it's a little bit different than in the US. You want to launch an online dating platform. You want to sell shoes online. You launch Netflix in France. What do you do? You buy a TV campaign. You know, if you want to get out with your online business model, you still have to buy TV, and you have to buy it in a massive way.
You want to launch
so
a movie.
So this
you
power
really
of reaching
of
a couple of million people in that one moment, you can't buy that anywhere, and that will go away. I think the content on linear will change. It's going to be a lot more local. You know, like for companies like ours producing in 25 territories, that's nice.
This was the point I was about to get to, which is that the other revenue stream that has been important is international, where this is an international panel, and selling internationally has been very important to content holders. But we had a conversation. You said a lot of the international buyers are saying, we got to get local. We can't keep buying.
If you look at free TV at the moment, I mean, in general, I think we're at a crossroad. This is free TV, and this is digital, and it's different stuff on different platforms. And in the free TV space, you look at any European market, you look at a universe of like roughly 20 to 30 free TV channels, most of them all digital now. In each of these markets, you have about two or three big commercial channels. And when you look at those market leaders, most of all prime time is local. Local drama, local entertainment, local news, local. And then they buy the acquisition product for some other slots. But
the percentage of local goes up. They're not spending as much buying international product as they used to, right?
And they're looking for, and it's also interesting what kind of international product they're looking for. You know, it's like, because over the last couple of years, especially out of America, out of the studio deals, you have a lot more like... The cool stuff that we like to watch, Harry Bosch, House of Cards, and all these shows we are all talking about. The highly serialized stuff doesn't repeat. The Game of Thrones doesn't repeat on free TV.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we're now getting constantly asked, do you have one of these good old boring shows. You know, it's like, and then what's boring? You know, it's
boring.
like closed-ended, episodical storytelling.
Really they still want that.
You know, the stuff that repeats, give me another bones, give me another mentalist, you know?
Yeah.
And we now go back into talking with
so
our production guys.
So that still sells.
Yeah.
That's still selling well.
Oh, that sells.
The boring
if you have
mentalist
that,
type
that's
of
like
thing.
Sliced bread, yeah.
The reason franchises like NCIS and CSI are in their 10th season or whatever, we actually talk about that a lot too. You know, as we all come under some pressure, more and more the entire global picture, the international point of view on content drives some of our investment decisions because we'd like to be able to say that we're going to just invest whatever we need to invest to create the content for our linear platforms in the United States, but that doesn't really, where we believe content ownership has become absolutely fundamental to the future. That's one of the clarifying principles that we came
that,
to.
That seems
we need to,
be, to
own our content.
Everybody agrees with that, right?
Yep. So, but
it's
owning
the time
premium,
is to own your own content.
But premium content is expensive, so more and more factors like you've mentioned become part of the equation. We talk creative groups that we have back, we talk a lot about that zig where everybody else is zagging, and I wouldn't be shocked to find that one of the next big breakouts in the United States is going to be some kind of closed-ended procedural storytelling with some kind of difference or some great character.
And I also think
we talk about that a lot, and if that happens, that'll be really good for everybody because that is more monetizable globally.
Yeah.
And when we were talking in development about this topic, our guy said, the cool showrunners don't want to do that old
stuff.
That's
right.
You know, and for a long time, I think that's really true. But on the other hand, the upside is the old boring stuff. You can do 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 seasons, highly serialized, complicated dramas. It's like character-driven stuff.
But you, but
3, 4 seasons.
One show.
It takes one show, the whole market.
And then all of a sudden, everybody wants to do the next version of
that. But right
now,
there's a disconnect because right now in the U.S., there's still a heavy demand, and everyone wants to do the serialized dark character.
Right.
Series.
The creative people are interested in doing things that they find more satisfying, and they may not find this kind of material satisfying.
But what's happening now is I think it is a global marketplace, and you're seeing the economic models coming out of Europe or the international market back in the US and vice versa. You're seeing, TF1, RTL, putting together a co-pro development model where they want to develop procedurals that then they can bring back in the US and reverse engineer it back in the US. There's 60 networks in the US that are commissioning original programming, so there's some networks that are saying, we just want to do procedurals. Mm-hmm. So, there's an opportunity for everyone, but there's no question, as Bob said, ownership is the key thing. If you're an integrated company, and obviously if you're a small niche creative player that just wants to create great content, you don't need to own it.
But you're not going to get rich.
You're not going to get rich the way, Mark Gordon, does Criminal Minds or Grey's Anatomy, the back end is huge.
Yes.
You do a show for Netflix, they buy out everything.
Yeah.
So, it's still great. There's something for everyone in this world. Mm-hmm. There's so many buyers out there.
More than ever.
You just have to figure out the economic model. That's tough.
Yeah.
And I think that's where partners, I think you're seeing more and more partners. We talked about this the other day. Obviously, we all want to own, but we all want the hit.
Right.
And hits take trial and error. You're going to have miss over and over and over again until you get a hit. So the idea of partnering and sharing risk becomes very important.
Right. In terms of the linear networks here, you now have an opportunity to own your product, right? That you didn't have before? Am I wrong about that?
No, we had that before. Now we have a new white piece of paper to work with in terms of the production community.
Uh-huh.
But we always could own content. We've owned content at Corus for 45 years.
Have you been able to own the programs you put on?
We've been able to own a certain amount of them. The new conversation suggests that there will be an opportunity for us to own a lot more should we want to go there. But I think a lot of this conversation is about the scripted world.
Yeah,
and there is an enormous world of content that's in the unscripted space, and an enormously powerful piece of our business is in the lifestyle unscripted space. And that isn't the same global economics. That's not the same global game. It's much, much more driven by advertising, which is very much about your own territory and back to the local point. So there are a lot of models in this, and I think we shouldn't all get too stuck that I have to outright own the next scripted drama if I'm going to be successful in this world. There's a lot of ways to live a life in a media business, and I think, it's looking to where your strengths are and where's the game you can win. And we've been winning big time in our lifestyle space and winning with advertisers and winning with viewers. It's interesting, we talk about shows, not brands, and I think in the scripted drama world, there's a lot of truth to that. When you move into the lifestyle space, people don't talk as much about shows. It still is a lot more about brand, and there still is a lot more of coming to a brand, a space, and maybe it's linear, maybe it'll be a website, maybe it'll be a streaming site, maybe it'll be an SVOD, I don't know, it doesn't matter, but where a brand just represents a whole collection of content that people are interested in. We've seen, you know, our ratings go up on HGTV and food this year, and that's different from just tracking whether this show or that show went up on global. They're they're very different things, and I think that's this, when we talk about TV everywhere, I mean, that's the business we're trying to figure out is it's everywhere, and which little piece of it can you play in successfully?
Well, one of the things that's sort of been interesting to me is that clearly there's been a necessity to create Canadian content, but people tell me that in Canada, a lot of times the audience, if they find out it's Canadian-based, they're less interested in it, which I'm fascinated by. There's no specific loyalty to Canadian production, and can that change? Is there a way to, does somebody have to hit, you know, a Breaking Bad or something to change that? Am I wrong in that?
No, I think you're wrong.
I wouldn't agree either.
I'm wrong.
Yeah, I think we're making the best Canadian content we ever have made as an industry. It's really solid. So, and I don't think viewers know where it comes from. They just know what they like. You know, I think that's the key.
Except in lifestyle, I would say, they absolutely know where it comes from, and they want it to be Canadian because they want to know about that product to use in their home or that restaurant to go and try or that whatever. So
it's more local, for sure, and that's why I say there's not a one-size-fits-all.
I want to make that point as well. You asked what are advertisers asking for? They like the unscripted format because of integrations, and that's how you deliver innovation in our challenging ad economy is through that format model. So, and they see local. So.
I think on the scripted side, it's a little more challenging in Canada. Yeah. There are some great shows, and Canadians love watching Canadian shows. You know, the truth is they don't care. They're agnostic. They want great stories, great characters. Of course, who doesn't like to see a story about their hometown or some way that they can connect beyond, you know, universal theme, something local. But it's tough when you're right next to the United States and you've got, you know, such great content where the investment in content is gigantic, where the development and the trial and error to get to great shows is immense. And it's a similar culture, same language, and everything comes in. So it's just, it's a competition issue. It's just, it's hard to compete.
All right, let's talk about the elephant in the room, maybe the T-Rex in the room. Netflix has become a big, you know, factor in everybody's mind going forward, I think. And I think it's particularly been interesting here because of how the system works. And I'm not, you know, I'm American, so I'm not totally sophisticated on this. But it seems to me that what I understand is happening is that you can see American Netflix here if you use an IP address in the U.S. And avoid and really get, you know, access to material that's supposed to be exclusive that people have paid for. And I'm just, I know Marianne has openly called that stealing. Is that right? You've said the word stealing.
It bothers me.
Right, it bothers you, yeah. So, but it seems like there's no overt recourse because I don't think the government is going to get involved, right? Yeah. And it sounded like you thought there had to be, I think you said a behavioral change,
well,
right?
Well, I think that it's confusing for people. It's not just here, it's any English-speaking country. When I was down in LA all for the international buy, the guys from South Africa, the guys from the UK, everyone, it's everywhere English-speaking. You can do it from anywhere in the world. So it's not just a Canadian issue. But the point was that it's complicated. Like, consumers aren't, it's too complicated to figure out what's here, what's there, what are the rights, who has this, who has that, and people don't think they're doing anything wrong. Okay, so how do we then reverse engineer what we do so that content can be monetized in an appropriate way to get from production to consumption in a way that treats everybody fairly along that chain, right? And I don't have the answers to that, but there has to be an answer because, you know, it's Netflix now. There are another four people that we don't even see coming up in the rearview mirror of Netflix, right? Mm-hmm.
We don't know where.
We don't even know about. So
another
it's,
disruptor
we
on this.
We have to sort of sort out what this all means in terms of this geogating and all that kind of stuff.
But they're now starting to change that.
Who is starting to change it?
Netflix. Mm-hmm. So we have at home, should I say, I don't know. We also have an American, I live in England, we have an American subscription to Netflix. Yeah. My wife
you have an American subscription?
That's the excuse.
That's the excuse.
That's the excuse. And
it's called a loophole.
American wife, you know. And using her American subscription within England. So it was 2 weeks ago we turned on Netflix and she was shocked.
Because
all her shows were gone. So they switched within the UK.
In the UK they switched.
In the UK they switched.
What made
you can only see
what
the
made
UK.
Them switch?
Companies like, you know, you have to, when you talk to me, you talk to Jens Private and Jens Business. So Jens Business was very angry with Netflix as well, like many of us.
But Jens Private was like, what happened to that show I was watching?
Yeah, that was very,
a season of Breaking Bad.
That was very disappointing. But anyhow, for my wife, not me. Okay. So I was very happy. And what happened to us, for instance, like an incident was we have a very successful show coming out of Australia called Wentworth, a woman prison show, a female prison show. And then we sold that to Netflix in the US. And it does great for them. It's like Orange is the New Black on steroids. It's a real thing. And it does really well. So, and because they make... So far, they made their subscription available everywhere, you know. We got into trouble in Australia before because Foxtel, the commissioning broadcaster, said, you know, like, we have a lot of guys in Australia through their Netflix US account watching Wentworth. It's our show, FYI.
Right.
No?
Yeah.
So there we had to start a discussion with Netflix, and I think... they didn't take care so much about it for most of the time.
Yeah.
I think latest when they're going to start their global feed and they're going to be everywhere, they're probably going to be accurate about it, I would imagine, and then limit it to the territory offering.
So they'll have global, but that'll cost them way more money, won't it? Won't Netflix, if they have to try to get global rights to everything?
We've made global deals with them, and I think that's clearly where they're moving, is to try and make, it creates all kinds of challenges, and for some respects, a company like ours that has a very robust international distribution, we have to be very smart about how we're going to deal with that, but they clearly seem to be have more of an appetite to pay more to acquire global rights. Quite frankly, to acquire rights for territories that they aren't yet in, but knowing that they intend to be in those territories sometimes.
Well, I think I saw the figure. It was 22% of the viewers here are using an American IP address to watch Netflix. Some very high figure.
It's a big number.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Netflix subscribers, right?
Yeah.
It, you know, it's an important note to say we all want to innovate. We know we got to follow the consumer. You know, our system in Canada, and I'm sure in Germany and other around the world, was... in the past built on is preserving a discrete rights market. And that's what's at risk here. And it can be solved. It's just important that we as an industry work through the framework and also innovate quickly to offer what they're offering.
But is anybody nervous who has a business here, and it would be the same with you, Bob, that if you do wind up selling to Netflix, you're like potentially undermining yourself by creating...
It is
frenemies.
It is the question as relates to the so-called OTT world, and it isn't just Netflix. Amazon has been very aggressive.
Yes,
Hulu is becoming the Kentucky Derby or something. They're in third, but they're charging hard and trying to catch up a little bit. But I think it is the question. My personal view, and I think a view that our company is coming around to, is look, yes, there is an extent to which, you know, by licensing all of this great content to these platforms, you're enabling them to offer an alternative. You're creating a different viewer expectation, and you're training the viewer, if you will, to consume content. Some would argue in an environment that is very consumer friendly. You don't have ads. You take it with you, etc.
Right.
Honestly, I think that's a little bit of the, you know, being, you know, how many times in history has technology lost? So I think that ultimately, at the end of the day, it, for example, at our networks, they're not just our viewers. Our viewers are our competitors' viewers, our broadcast viewers. It's just about what share of the time you have. Those audience, the cat's out of the bag. You know, viewer behavior is going to change. Consumers are going to adopt technologies that allow them to have more choice in how they consume their media. So, you know, you could say, here, I'm tilting at windmills and I'm not going to sell to these guys because right. I'm training my viewers to watch differently. Well, it's too late, personally.
We're talking about, you know, like when we talk OTT, we're always talking like global and danger and da-da-da-da-da. I mean, these platforms popping up like mushrooms, you know, it's like you have them everywhere. So if you're a linear broadcaster today, you extend into non-linear. You mm-hmm. have your own platform. Like for instance, yesterday on broadcast in the UK, it came out that Channel 4 is backing GSN now, that is Global Series Network. So it's like there's a broadcast channel in the UK coming up with his own digital platform, which then they probably intend to bring into other territories. You know, it's like, and you have that everywhere. So I think there's a lot of, for guys like us, there's going to be a lot of choice in different places, and some of these places are going to be local, and some are international.
And I think we're all having to try these disruptive things right. and be willing to disrupt ourselves when we figure it out. Yeah. I mean, you call it Crave, we call it Show Me, but we're doing we're leaping right into the lion's den there and doing it proactively and consciously to experiment with it and try it. I think, to your point, all these things are mushrooming everywhere, and to the consumer, who ultimately is our God, you know, they're looking for ease and they're looking for value. Right. And the ease part is actually getting more complicated again. Someone was telling me the other day that they are on their TV at home is satellite. It has bazillions of channels. They know what shows they like. They have no idea where anything is. So they Google. They Google, what channel do I find whatever show on? And then they turn on their good old-fashioned TV and go to that channel. But yeah. they can't do it without Google because they're lost. Yeah. Like, and I think tons of people are doing that. They have no idea where to find anything. And now in Canada, it's not all on Netflix. It might be on Netflix. It might be on Crave. It might be on Show Me. So even if I've decided mm-hmm. as a consumer I want to do the streaming thing, I'm still faced with an array of choice and confusion yeah. about what I find
smart,
where.
Smart company.
Windows on top of
oh,
that.
Oh, yeah, right? yeah, and the windowing. So, you know, I saw it last week on this channel, but it's gone off that channel. Well, now it's actually on Global Go. I can find it there for a little while, but it's going to be gone there, too, and then it's going to be over yeah. on Show Me. Yeah. So, you know, part of our challenge here as a collective industry is this discoverability, which I'm already tired of that word, and we've only been using it for a month or two. But it's the organization, the curation, the editing, and in some ways, you know, that's what linear television does yeah. so well. Like, for a long time, we had a point of view that what Global did for you was find you the very best in premium content and put it out there for you every night of the week.
You know, it's interesting that what generally has happened, which is I thought would never happen, is that television, to me, always one of the great advantages of it was that it was a passive experience. Because you came home, you turned it on, you had a busy day, and you just... Yeah. sat down in front of your television set. And as it becomes more, you have to make strategic moves to watch yeah, television. Yeah. It's truly changing the entire experience. And I also wonder about how they calculate how much am I going to spend on this. You know, if I'm spending whatever, $9 for Netflix, do I want to spend, you know, another chunk of money on Amazon or I don't know how you're selling Show Me and Crave, but you know, eventually, you don't want to buy everything. You can't buy everything.
Well, that's
so
the value side of this, right? So somehow it's still too complicated, and somehow it's actually still feeling too expensive, and we haven't got that equation figured out for consumers. Never mind for I think as you very well said that production to consumption. We haven't got that model figured out to make the value equation actually make sense to that end user.
The value is a good point as well. In the US, I think, what's the premium pay TV package you can buy? How much money can you spend per month? $200 or with everything in there?
I'm spending about $230
at least.
$230. But that includes my Wi-Fi though. So, you know, that's
so a good $200. Yeah. A good $200. So if you in Germany, for instance, and you have the premium Sky package, it's $50.
$50.
You know, so if you, and if you come into a European market and you're offering another cheap SVOD offering for another $10, some of these Europeans are really cheap. They don't like to spend money. 10 a month is a lot of money, you know? Like 10 versus 200.
You're characterizing 200, the whole continent. You know, the,
I'm glad you
most
said
of them are cheap. And I was like, sorry. And so I think you're going to also see it's like the penetration of digital services. It's going to very much going to go by the... It's going to come, there's no doubt about it, but it's going to be by region, and some are going to be a lot faster than others.
It seems to me that, you know, you're right, and I think that, you know, in a couple of ways, I think we're going to see a saturation point in some of this. We're noticing in the United States. Yeah. But I mean, I think, you know, at the end of the day, I think all of this ends up actually the consumer is going to benefit from all this, because one of the things, of course, we're seeing is the...
Unless he goes broke.
Yeah, right. Well, but what I mean by that is there's going to be... So the cable industry in the United States, I completely agree with what you said, but I would also say that you're starting to see the traditional MSO response to the OTT offerings, and you're starting to see these skinny packages, yeah, and the slimmed down packages, right, and the more customized offerings. These are all things that they're forced to do because the consumer has an alternative or has multiple alternatives now. And in that way, I think at the end of the day, the consumer gets to customize a little bit more how they're spending their money. But I do agree that, you know, we're in very, very early days of OTT. And, you know, you have, okay, I think it sneaks up on you quickly. I bought HBO Now. And, oh, now Showtime's got their OTT off. Well, I like that show. I'm going to walk by that, too. And yeah, I have Hulu Plus. I even forgot. Now, that's going away. And I'm still paying for it, probably. And, you know, and you go on and on and on. And, then, and you know, you look up and you're spending well over $100 a month. That's before you start to your music input, streaming, yeah, services. Right. Oh, I forgot I pay for Spotify.
Sirius Radio. You can really,
right, and I think that there will be that is a marketplace that will reach an equilibrium at some point. Mm-hmm. But right now I don't think anybody quite knows, you know,
so
exactly
wondering if there's
if there's
an opportunity for somebody going forward to like appeal to all the cheap people, you know,
SOs are doing that now. Yeah. They're absolutely doing that now. Yeah. With, you know, their basics.
I mean, like, give somebody an opportunity. You can pay, or you can watch ads. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That you can, we'll give you a lot of content, but you have to watch ads. I mean, has somebody proposed something like that?
Well, I think you're watching the music services start to figure that,
sure,
out, right? They all started as subscription,
right,
services, and
mm-hmm,
now lots of them are offering two versions. You can get the ad-free version and pay a monthly subscription, or you can get the ad-filled version.
Yeah.
And
I think we're going to see
tons of mixed, mm-hmm, models that way, and hybrids where maybe you only pay $2 in subscription and you get a few ads. Because, you know, to go back to where you started, I think there's a growing amount of evidence out there now that it's not that young people won't watch any ads. They don't want to watch 4 minutes of them in a row, and
yes,
they don't want to watch things that have no relevance to them whatsoever. But when you reduce the amount of advertising and you start to target it to be meaningful for who they are and what they're interested in.
And make it really creative.
And make
right?
it, yeah, make it great content. Mm-hmm. I think there's lots of room for ads. So I think we're going to see hybrids all over the place with this.
Okay, I'm going to get questions from the audience, but before I do, I'm going to ask one quick thing of everybody. What's the one most important thing people should think about in the business right now? Go.
So glad I started
The most
one thing.
Well, the biggest challenge for us going forward will be, like, for distributors is, we spoke about that before, is exploitation by territory.
Okay.
That's
Bob.
Understand what you do best, where you fit into this giant ecosystem, and invest.
John?
Quickly.
Rigor in the content we create, from a development all the way through to a production execution.
Doug?
Innovate business models.
Marianne?
The power of broadband.
Barb?
Power of data.
Okay, that's everybody knows now what the important things are. So, anyone have a question for our erudite panel right here?
Goings. And besides money, the other limiting factor is time, right? And my math might be wrong, but there's only 24 hours in the day, and it seems we make probably the best shows we've ever been making. People seem to be consuming more programming, but what are they not doing? Do you guys have any sense on what consumers are not doing as they're consuming more television? And then, I guess the flip of that is, what's the risk that they might do something else? Is it video gaming? Is it Oculus Rift? Is it going out for dinner? You know, where are consumers spending their time?
I'll jump in real fast. I think that's just a great point. I mean, we talk about the business that we are in at ANI as being essentially in the leisure business. And so essentially what we are doing, we are competing for people's time, their leisure time. So they work and they sleep and there's leisure and they can be doing all kinds of different things. I think in the US there's a sense that there's so much more consumption of television, but honestly it's not that much more than it has. It's up but marginally up overall. There's more choice and more fragmentation, which gets into a lot of the problems that we're all talking about here. But I think to really answer your question, it goes well beyond what I can certainly, the time we have here, it really depends on who you're talking about, and particularly are they men, are they women, and what are their ages. And so, you know, gaming is an enormous challenge to each one of us up on this stage for younger men. Mm-hmm. It's a bit of a different answer for young women, you name it. But it is absolutely not lost on us that at the end of the day, we're competing for leisure time in a relatively fragmented world where the overall consumption of content is up marginally.
Question was right there, I think.
Hi. Do you guys feel that we have hit peak linear from both a subscriber and a revenue perspective? And if so, what do you see as the sort of most compelling tools that are going to help you continue to either maintain or continue to grow your business?
I'll take that one. I don't think we've hit peak linear necessarily, because the tools that you need to grow is having the whole basket of rights. So when we're talking to the distributors about negotiating for channels, if we can provide all the rights that audiences want to consume, then we can grow our revenues. If you can't provide all those rights, I think maybe you're looking at a tougher conversation. But the key, I think, in linear is to control more of the rights so you can deliver value across all platforms.
So it's semantics a bit, I think. I mean, I agree, we haven't peaked in terms of our opportunity to exploit the value of the content that's currently on, you know, maybe starts its life cycle on the linear platform, but just narrowly defined as a linear signal and a traditional measurement of the audience on that. I'm smiling because we were writing a report for the board a little while ago, and we had a great debate about the word peak and whether we were prepared to say we are peaking, we have peaked, we are about to peak, and we had a lot of debate about that phrase for a while, which just says to me we're sitting right around there. But to Doug's point, that's sort of okay, because that's the beginning of the life cycle. That may become more and more about the marketing of the life cycle of that content, and so it becomes about the further exploitation. So it's okay if we've almost peaked.
I don't think the content
could be a second peak beyond the first peak.
Yeah, that second mountain range is right
back
there.
Back to your mountain analogy again.
I just realized I can't see this part of the room, but are any other questions out there? Anyone?
Someone in the back. Back here in the corner, yes.
Okay, yes.
With all of the new entrants into the marketplace and all the discussion about the new sources of programming, are we creating a program supply bubble? And is there going to be a little bit of a flame out and the usual kind of market contraction? Because it seems to me that there just isn't enough appetite to consume in an economically effective way all the stuff that's being made.
John, you take that.
Well, I can certainly answer from a B2B point of view, because as a distributor selling content around the world, I mean, our volume is increasing. We're seeing license fees go up in some areas, especially, again, very high-end content. But in the middle, there's just, buyers don't have budgets to spend anymore, because there's just so much. And as to Jen's point, there's so much local content being created, they're spending it on that. They're spending a lot of money on the big event shows. So we're seeing definitely from an economic point of view and from a license fee point of view that the middle is being squeezed.
You know, one of the interesting facts is that Netflix is spending more, their growth in content is exceeding their growth in revenues right now. And that's kind of like the Federal Reserve, having liquidity in rates. We have liquidity in funding for content. And at the same time, we don't really have, the traditional models adapting fast enough. So I think it's a very smart question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyone else? I can barely see in these lights, so. If not, I'm going to ask one last question of the panel, which is one of the oldest quotes in the entertainment business is that nobody knows anything. Do you folks go to work every day and think I know something, or I really don't know anything?
So
anyone want to answer
yeah, it's,
that?
It's, I'll start. It's William Goldman. It's a fantastic
William Goldman,
quote.
Yes.
The quote's actually a little bit longer than that
it is,
because he goes
yes.
on to he goes on to talk about nobody knows anything
in
which
movies.
I completely in movies. Yes, well, yeah. But you know, let's yeah. take it. But he does go on to talk that all you can hope for is to have an educated guess, and
right.
I think that that's also a very important part of it. I would say nobody. You know, I would say the one thing that I think we take some solace in, and I think maybe some of you on this panel, is there are certain things that haven't changed and probably never will change in this business, and one of them is a hit does change everything. And I think in some level we are all looking for that next big breakout show, and when you're talking about that, nobody knows anything. I would agree 100%.
That's for sure.
And that hit would make it on any platform.
Any platform.
Any
It'll
platform.
Change the
a
game
hit works
any
anywhere,
platform.
Right? Okay.
Absolutely.
Thanks to this great panel. And,